Hello, and welcome back to our introduction to the security domain. This content was created by the Splunk education team just for you. In our first video, we reviewed a few important events in history to help us understand how we got to the current state of security. Now we're going to dive into, well, security and how to approach it. Let's start with, what exactly are we protecting with cybersecurity? Well, at a high level, we want to protect everyone. You, a company's resources and intellectual property, a hospital's ability to keep running and attending patients while keeping the records secure, a small business that uses an online payroll software. Really, anything that is connected to the World Wide Web. Now, each of the scenarios present different security risks and challenges, so it can be difficult to imagine how we can apply a single concept like cybersecurity to all of them. Luckily, there are some frameworks and regulations that can help with that. Starting with the type of data that should be protected. While data comes in many shapes and sizes, there are a few examples of very common data that we all interact with. For example, information that can be used to identify one person, like a combination of a full name and date of birth, or a unique identifier like a social security number, is usually classified as PII, personal identifiable information. There are laws and regulations that define PII in detail and control what rights and responsibilities individuals and organizations have regarding this type of data. Information that surrounds your health and well-being is known as PHI, Protected Health Information. This can include insurance information, recent laboratory testing results, or a complete medical diagnosis. You probably want to decide whom to share this information with, so there are also special rules governing the sharing of this data. Another example is information about payment card status and usage, and that is regulated via the Payment Card Information or PCI standard. For example, the three-digit code on the back of most credit cards can never be stored by an organization since if someone acquired that along with some other information, they could use your credit card without your authorization. I imagine we can all agree that this information should be protected, either for your privacy or to protect you from fraud. And that's why organizations that have access to your data might have to uphold regulations like the European Union General Data Protection Regulation, or EU GDPR, the US Government's Health Information Portability and Accountability Act, or HIPAA, the US Government's Federal Information Security Modernization Act, FISMA, the Payment Card Industry's Data Security Standard, PCI-DSS, just to name a few. Each of these have different rules and technical requirements for operating with specific categories of information, and they all attempt to address slightly different pieces of the cyber puzzle. Add to these the fact that organizations also want to protect their own proprietary, confidential, or financial information. And this is where cybersecurity usually begins, identifying the assets that can put us at risk, finding out where they are located, and then deciding the best way to protect them. Now, what do we mean by protect? Well, a good place to begin is reviewing the principles of the CIA Triad. This is not the US government agency, but the cybersecurity model that refers to confidentiality, integrity, and availability. Confidentiality means ensuring that protected information is only seen by those who are meant to see it. Organizations can implement confidentiality measures through authentication and authorization policies, as well as by limiting access to a network or by adding physical security to limit access to certain resources. Confidentiality also applies to data in motion. For example, if you're sending an email or a message, you want that communication to be visible only to your intended recipient. So this is where you would want to make sure that the apps that you're using have end-to-end encrypted communication channels. Integrity ensures that you can trust the data, that it hasn't been maliciously tampered with, it is accurate, consistent, and it can only be changed under valid situations. Aside from authorization mechanisms to limit who can modify data, one-way hashes can be used to confirm the integrity of a file, for example. Or maybe you've heard about the blockchain technology? Availability sounds a bit more obvious. It means that the data is available for those who need it when they need it. And it is also important because my data can be accurate and private, but if I can't access it when I need it, then what's the point? So availability covers, for example, protecting systems against denial of service attacks, as well as having data or infrastructure backups in case something is lost, compromised, or broken. So for data to be protected and secure, there should be mechanisms that ensure that it is only disclosed to authorized users, and that it won't be maliciously altered, destroyed, or made unavailable. The picture is a little more clear if you start focusing on these areas, right? So how do we approach this? Well, as an individual, the best place to start is being aware of the risks and taking the time to see what actions you can take to minimize them. Think about yourself, in your life, what should be kept confidential? What should keep its integrity? And what should always be available to you? And start there. Once we get into this mindset, it's easy to be more proactive with our day-to-day actions. If I'm sharing my personal information, who am I giving it to? Is it a trusted entity or organization? Are my important accounts protected with two-factor authentication or with strong enough passwords? And yes, I said passwords, plural, because you shouldn't be using the same password everywhere. And so on with everything that we do on a daily basis. Now, if we take this to the organizational level, it gets a bit more complicated. But thankfully, there are tools designed to provide a roadmap for companies to build a cybersecurity implementation that works for them. One of those examples is the cybersecurity framework managed by the US National Institute of Standards and Technology, commonly referred to as NIST. It brings together various NIST special publications into a single digestible framework that serves as a convenient tool for starting or reinforcing security practices within an organization. We could spend a lot of time diving into this and other cybersecurity frameworks, but for the purpose of this video, we will just focus on one of the components of the NIST cybersecurity framework, the NIST Core. The NIST Core is a set of desired cybersecurity activities and outcomes organized into functions, categories, and subcategories. All the way down to the subcategories, the framework is meant to cover the breadth of cybersecurity objectives for an organization in outcome-driven statements. Outcome-driven means that it will tell you an action that needs to be completed, but it will leave it up to each organization to decide what's the best way to do it. Let's see some examples. According to NIST, these five functions were selected because they represent the five primary pillars for a successful and holistic cybersecurity program, helping organizations get a better understanding of their risk and how to manage it. So, to build a security program, the first step is to identify what are we going to protect. An outcome in this category would be, for example, identifying physical and software assets within the organization. If you couple that with identifying asset vulnerabilities, this helps prevent some of the scenarios we discussed during our first video. And this makes sense. You first need to know which assets need to be protected, either due to privacy, regulations, or just to keep operating. And then we figure out how to protect these assets. Sample outcomes of this function are to have protections for identity management and access control, including physical and remote access. Or another one is managing protective technology. Authentication policies, firewalls, antivirus software, data loss prevention solutions, email and web security gateways, and many more technologies and solutions would be implemented or strengthened as part of the review of this function. This also includes empowering staff within an organization through awareness and training to prevent potential issues related to user error. Once systems, processes, and solutions have been identified, we need to see if they are actually working. And here is where the detect function comes in to enable the timely discovery of cybersecurity events. An outcome in this function would be, for example, implementing security continuous monitoring capabilities to monitor events and verify effectiveness of protective measures. In this function, a security information and event manager software, or SIEM, like Splunk Enterprise Security, could be implemented. A SIEM collects logs and events from multiple types of systems and allows analysts to correlate all this data so they can see if there's something suspicious going on. If a cybersecurity event occurs, the respond function supports the ability to contain its impact. Here is where the organization will make sure to have a plan that includes, for example, forensic analysis, how to determine the impact of incidents, managing communications, and more. mitigation activities to prevent the expansion of an event, and to resolve it would also fall in this area. Aside from developing processes and runbooks, orchestration tools like Splunk SOAR would be helpful at this stage, since it can connect with several systems, including network devices, and automate incident response activities like blocking a URL, email, or IP address that has been identified as malicious or risky. Finally, the recover function supports the timely recovery to normal operations. This includes outcomes like implementing improvements based on lessons learned, and recovery planning processes and procedures to restore systems and/or assets. An example here would be having backups of critical data and systems, or like a second route to redirect traffic in case of an issue with the primary one. And that's it. As I mentioned before, this is only one of the frameworks and tools available to help organizations approach cybersecurity. But I picked this one for this video because it makes it easy to see at a high level a roadmap of how organizations can implement or improve their security posture. To learn more about the five functions of the cybersecurity frameworks, you can visit the NIST website. If you're thinking this is a lot, yes, it is. And that's why there are different roles and cyber teams that focus on different areas. Each area requires different skills and approaches, but all usually benefit from people who have that spark of curiosity that leads to creating new things, to finding new paths, finding the truth behind an event, and finding new ways to break into systems, but in this case, so it can be prevented. A common classification of cyber teams talks about red and blue teams, where the red team are the breakers, who use offensive tactics to test existing defenses, and the blue team are the defenders, who hunt for threats and defend operations. However, I particularly like the InfoSec color wheel approach that April Wright presented at Black Hat in 2017, because it casts a wider net on who's responsible for security and reminds us that it is important to have a robust collaboration across teams, including the yellow team, which refers to the builders or software coders. And again, this makes a lot of sense. The more we think about security at all levels, the better prepared we will be when the next threat strikes. Or at least, we can minimize our chances of having a catastrophic loss along the way. Now, in a perfect world, we would have unlimited resources to protect everything that needs to be protected. Unfortunately, this is not the reality. There are time, economic, and even personal limitations. A quick internet search will show you several discussions about our current cybersecurity personnel shortage, for example. And all of these needs to be considered when implementing a security strategy. So security is everything we discussed today and more, but it is also a constant struggle to keep balance between the risks, the resources, and keeping systems functional and user-friendly. This is part of what makes security as a whole so challenging, and why having everyone participate in it, including you, helps us all. Thank you for taking this journey down the security domain with me. I really hope you learned something today. If you want to learn more, there are several resources available online, including within Splunk. Here you can also learn how Splunk can help organizations with their cybersecurity needs. And don't forget to visit our education website for in-person, virtual, and on-demand Splunk courses. Thank you for watching.